Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son.
Good morning to you all, Ata Marie, wherever you are, welcome to the service. Congratulations, I think the ultra marathon is just about over. Just a few more days and we will be released, we hope. So I want to start today's service. Today's service is a little bit different. I'm trying to incorporate a number of things. We're going to celebrate St. Andrew's Day today, or commemorate it at least. That is the 30th of November. Interestingly, my son Andrew's oldest boy was born on St. Andrew's Day, and that only just dawned on me as I was preparing a little bit about St. Andrew for you in a moment. So that's one of the things we're going to do, and we're welcoming the McLeod clan today. Because if we had been meeting in person, they would have been here with their kilts on and the skirl of the pipes. But I've got a bit of skirling to come in one of our hymns very shortly. So we've got that component today. And so what I've done is prepared two homilies. Now, most of the St. Andrew's people know when I say a homily, it means a short sermon. So we have two separate homilies today at different points in the service. And kids, hopefully you'll be listening to the St. Andrew's one at least. And I've got a song, a great song, not just for kids, for you. So here we go. Let's launch forth. Let's commence our worship now with that wonderful hymn to focus our attention on our holy and wonderful God. Our special God, that's what that word holy means. Very, very special, or as young kids would say, awesome God. Let's sing this together now.
Holy, 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 holy
Let's join together in prayer now. Let us pray. Yes, God, we are so grateful that we come within your orb of attention, that your love has reached out to us, and we call ourselves your people. And so we thank you for that membership in this worldwide family, and we pray that we would experience your presence and our worship, albeit by the strange means. But we ask that you will once again encourage us, speak to us, give us hope for the days ahead. Help us to be mindful of those less fortunate than us. Forgive us, Lord, when we have complained about little things and forgotten about the big things that are confronting so many people in our nation, but in our world. And so once again, Lord, we dedicate to you the reading of the word. We thank you that new people have joined us in this last week and are sharing together in this service. Bless them, Lord, and be in our music and be the focus of our worship this day, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so in a moment, I'm going to give you my tribute to St. Andrew, but we have one of the McLeods. Alex McLeod is going to read to us from the Gospels, an interesting part of the Gospels about where Andrew plays a significant role. Thank you, Alex.
John 1:35-42. John's disciples follow Jesus. The next day, John was there again, and two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 PM. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We've found the Messiah, that is, the Christ." And he brought them to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which, when translated, is Peter.
And so this is the first of the two very brief homilies. And in honor of St. Andrew and St. Andrew's Day, I have a little dissertation on him. The name Andrew is of Greek origin, even though Andrew was a Jew from a Hebrew family born in Bethsaida, which is in Galilee. The name means courageous. It's interesting that the Greek Orthodox Church, the Byzantine Church, calls Andrew proto-kletos, which means the first called, or the one who was called first. And if you look through the Gospels, it appears that indeed Andrew was the first disciple to be called to Jesus. Church tradition has that Andrew became a great missionary and evangelist, and he headed east, north as well. This is the church tradition. It's not in the Bible, but to Romania, Georgia, the Black Sea area, Ukraine, and even possibly made it as far as Russia. And some of those countries have him as their patron saint as well as Scotland. And also church tradition and early good documentation supports the notion that he was crucified 60 AD. And of course, the cross on which church tradition tells us that he was crucified on was the St. Andrew's, the shape of the St. Andrew's cross. As far as Scotland is concerned, the legend has it that Picts and Scots outnumbered the Angles in a great battle. I think somewhere around the 8th century, might have been 9th century, against the Angles, who of course are the Sassenachs over the border. And before battle, even though they were hopelessly outnumbered, they saw in the cloud the sign of a St. Andrew's cross. And they attributed their success in that battle. They had victory. An individual, one of the leaders, it's spelt O-E-N-G-U-S, and I imagine that in Scottish is Angus, or Ungus, or Ingus. He proclaimed Andrew to be the patron saint of Scotland, so the legend goes. My wife has been reading a book by the Reverend Dr. Peter Marshall, and he is a Scottish Presbyterian minister who immigrated to the United States. And I have a number of quotes because he has a whole chapter on Andrew. He later on became, he went to Washington as minister to New York Avenue Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C., where our oldest son and his wife and our granddaughter now live. Peter Marshall became the chaplain to the U.S. Senate from about 1948, so just post-Second World War. So here's some interesting quotes from Peter Marshall's book, which is called Mr. Jones, Meet the Master. And he says the following about Andrew. Andrew has usually been referred to as Simon Peter's brother. He himself was not a leader of men. He was not as aggressive as Simon. We find him usually playing second fiddle to his famous brother. And we know perfectly well that it takes a lot of grace to play second fiddle. And again, it is not easy to live out your life day after day and week after week and year after year in a subordinate position while somebody else gets all the notice, the publicity, the attention, the credit, the praise, and the spotlight, and perhaps the reward. It takes a lot of grace to accept a role like that. And yet Andrew seems never to have complained. And then we read that it was Andrew who said in the Gospels, the Gospel of Matthew, there is a boy here, to Jesus. He has 5 barley loaves and a couple of fish. And I suppose it was perfectly natural for the lad to share his lunch with Andrew. Why? Because this man had noticed him and befriended him. And so he brought the boy to Jesus. And just continuing some of Peter Marshall's words here about St. Andrew. He really might be called Andrew the Introducer. Andrew is not one of the greatest of disciples, but he is typical of those folk of generous sympathy to others and of sound common sense, without whom the success of and great venture, the success of a great venture can never be assured. The vast majority of people fall into the second fiddle class of people, the useful host of mediocrity, the average men and women, who are always taken for granted, but without whom nothing can ever be achieved. Andrew. They are willing to play second fiddle, you see. They know that they will not be singled out for honours or medals. They have a job to do, and they are willing to do it without complaint. and often with the bravery and consecration of the highest order, they are willing not only to lose their identities in a job to be done, but even to lose their lives for the sake of others. They have discovered the truth of the paradox of Christianity, and I love this bit here. They've discovered the truth of the paradox of Christianity, that only by losing one's life can one find it. And I never knew this last little fact, again from Reverend Dr. Peter Marshall. It is not without significance that Andrew was chosen to be the patron saint of Scotland, and the St. Andrew's Cross, a diagonal white cross on a blue background, is the foundation on which the St. George's Cross of England is laid and the St. Patrick's Cross of Ireland is placed to make up the Union Jack. Never knew that. Andrew was first and at the bottom. And I think that sums up beautifully the character of St. Andrew. And we gladly, as our heritage in this church, gladly take his name and celebrate and give thanks for his life. All right, folks, I thought what would be an appropriate song or hymn is Amazing Grace, but with a bit of a Scottish brogue to it, if you like. The skirl of the pipes will be clear as we sing this amazing hymn about God's amazing grace. Wasn't that a great rendition of that fantastic song? We're now going to go to a slide that has my voice on it and wants to point out a few things to our St. Andrew's family. And then we'll be back again with a song for the kids.
So some very special notices this morning as you look forward to meeting together next week in the church. This is only possible, unfortunately, for double vaxxed folk, but if you're not vaccinated, you can still be part of the service through our live streaming, which will commence at the beginning of the service time, 10 o'clock next Sunday morning. We're able to sing again, which will be great, but we have to wear masks inside. And if children under 12 are used to wearing masks at school, then they should continue to bring those and wear them at the service. There will be good ventilation with windows open. Vaccine certificates need to be checked. That's mandated by the government prior to entry, and there'll also be a scanning or a written attendance record, which either suits you best. Unfortunately, no morning tea or refreshments, and I'm sure you'll be passing the peace, but doing that by signals only. If you got any questions about any of this or your vaccine status and how you give evidence of that, contact the office on that email or phone the office. It should be staffed from Tuesday until Friday. That is our hope. And then it's just a little reminder that you've been fantastic, our friends and members, in supporting with the continued offerings to our church. And this will be the last you'll hear from me for 4 weeks or so, depending on the borders. Dot and I have to be in Australia to complete the sale of a property we have here, and also we'll be spending time with family at Christmas. I wish you all an incredibly blessed Christmas, and hopefully you can all get together with your friends and family. God bless.
One of the fascinating things, kids, about Andrew, Saint Andrew, but Andrew the disciple who is Saint Andrew, is that he's known to be one that led people to Jesus, who brought people to Jesus. In fact, he brought his older brother, Simon Peter, who's more famous than he is. But we see he also finds this kid in the crowd at the feeding of the 5,000. And it's as if, you know, he's already chummed up with him. You know, he's already talked to him and made the boy feel good about himself. And we know that he was reflecting the way in which Jesus befriended people and was a friend. And so here is a version of what a friend we have in Jesus. It's one of my favorite songs, as I've said to the adults. It's actually got some pretty good theology in it as well. So let's sing this together now.
G'day, I'm Colin Buchanan, and I'm in lockdown. And look, I usually sing songs for children. I do a lot of singing of songs for kids, Christian songs. But a friend of mine said, hey, you're leaving out a very important group in our congregation. There are a lot of the elderly who are unable to be part of church, like all of us. And we would love to have a few hymns sung for them. And I love some of these old hymns. And the song we're going to sing now, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, is a dearly loved hymn. But let me read the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be opened. You get the sense that God wants us to pray, don't you? And I remember growing up, there were some elderly faithful saints who were in aged care facilities, and they'd lost their mobility, they'd lost much of their family, they were isolated, But they prayed. And when we went and visited them, they would assure us that they were praying. They knew the missionaries' kids by names, and they struggled in their frailty, but they struggled in prayer too. And perhaps that's because they spent a long time singing a hymn like this, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." So let's have a crack at it together, shall we?
Have a time of intercession, and following the intercessions we have a song again of praise and reaching out to God, and then I'll be back with you.
We pray for the needs of the world. We pray for the families of the 27 refugees who died this week while attempting to cross the English Channel. As they travelled to escape the harsh reality of the country where they originated from, to get to a country where they hoped to be safer and live a better life. For their families and those affected by the situation, I pray for you to comfort them, wipe away the tears from their eyes, and help them to experience your love. I also pray for the authorities that you would give them the wisdom to take effective action against people smugglers, so that similar situations are avoided in future.
I pray that you would protect the many refugees and their families from the weather, from people who try to take advantage because of the situations the refugees find themselves in. You, O Lord, are our strength and high tower. We run to you for protection. I pray that you would intervene. We remember other events, the families affected because of the Wisconsin parade rampage. We pray for your healing to those who are affected, both mentally and physically. We pray for the ongoing situation relating to COVID around the world and the new variant. We pray for various countries as they take steps to overcome the pandemic and return to the new normal. I pray for the doctors, nurses, and other healthcare providers that you would give them your rest and rejuvenate them. We pray for the people who are affected because of wars, acts of terrorism, natural or man-made disasters. You, O Lord, are the Prince of Peace. Let the affected know of your protection at all times. Through these difficult times, I pray that you would reveal yourselves to each and every one caught up in their circumstances, and that they would feel your presence with them and know of your saving grace. We pray for those that serve you in easy and not so easy situations. We pray that they would enjoy your protection in their well-being. We pray for the needs of our nations. We look back over the past 3+ months, where we as a nation, especially Auckland, have been in lockdown. These circumstances have affected many families as a result of unemployment, anxiety, depression, barriers keeping families and friends from meeting each other. We pray and commit the plan to you, O Lord, that the government have put in place for us as a nation to recover and move forward. For those in power and they that make decisions that affect our daily lives, I pray that you would grant them your wisdom to make informed decisions that affect us as a nation. I pray that you would help the people in New Zealand to recover mentally, physically, financially, and spiritually as well. I pray that your peace that passeth all understanding fills the hearts of our nations, and that people would be drawn to you. I pray that people would hunger for the true gospel of Jesus Christ and for a Christian spiritual revival in New Zealand. As we will be entering into the season of Christmas, I pray that people would be made aware of who Jesus Christ is, what he did for mankind. I pray that you would make people to have a receptive heart and come to know of his saving grace.
We pray for the needs of our church family. Father, you are good, and you are good all the time. I pray you would speak to us in a way that we would understand and help us to continue to be faithful to you. Fill us with the hunger and thirst to study your word and grow closer to you. We pray for families that are grieving the loss of a dear family member. We remember Shahi and extended family. We remember Seya and Nobu. We remember other members in our church family, from all the congregations who have lost near and dear ones, some who cannot return to their families and be with them because of the current situation. For all of them, dear Lord, I pray that they would feel your peace and comfort through your presence in their lives. We remember and pray for the elderly in our church, the members who do not keep good health, those who are hurting, those that find themselves in difficult situations. I pray that you would be with the people who take care of them, family members, support people, that they would minister to them. We thank you for the health and finances of our church. We thank you for the elders, the managers, the committee members, the Sunday school teachers, parents, the children, and everyone who attend either physically or online, that your holy presence would be with each one of them and meet them at the point of their need. We also pray for a special blessing on Johannes and David, our church ministers, their immediate and extended families. You, O Lord, are our Father, and beneath us are your everlasting arms. We thank you. We join together and pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I come, God, I come. Return to the Lord, the one who's broken, the one who's torn me apart. You strike down to bind me up. You say you do it all in love, that I might know you in your suffering. And though you slay me, yet I will praise you. Though you take from me, I will bless your name. Though you ruin me, still I will sing a song to the one who's all I need. My heart and flesh may fail, the earth below give way, but with my eyes, with my eyes, I'll see the Lord lifted high. On that day, behold the Lamb that was slain, and I'll know that every tear was worth it all. And though you slay me, yet I will praise you. Though you take from me, your name, though you ruin me, still I will worship, sing a song to the one who's all I need. Though the night I'm crying out, this cup pass from me now. You're still more than I need. You're enough for me. You're enough for me. Though you slay me, yet I will praise you. Though you take from me, I will bless your name. Though you ruin me, still I will worship, sing a song to the one who's all I need. I'll sing a song to the one who's all I need.
And so we have two further readings that will be read to us by Victoria and Ben. One is that great passage from Isaiah 40, and the other is Hebrews 12. Thank you, Victoria and Ben.
Isaiah chapter 40, verses 25 to 31. To whom can the holy God be compared? Is there anyone else like him? Look up at the sky. Who created the stars you see? The one who leads them out like an army, he knows how many there are and calls each one by name. His power is so great, not one of them is ever missing. Israel, Why then do you complain that the Lord doesn't know your troubles or care if you suffer injustice? Don't you know? Haven't you heard? The Lord is the everlasting God. He created all the world. He never grows tired or weary. No one understands his thoughts. He strengthens those who are weak and tired. Even those who are young grow weak. Young people can fall exhausted. But those who trust in the Lord for help will find their strength renewed. They will rise on wings like eagles. They will run and not get weary. They will walk and not grow weak.
Romans chapter 8, verses 18 to 39. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay, and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart.
So thus far in these 3 months in lockdown, I have resisted the temptation to do anything precisely thematic on living through a pandemic. This is probably, well, it will be my last sermon that you will hear, or homily, remember these are just homilies, from me for a little while. So here goes, some reflections, my learnings from a pandemic. We have often said over this last year that out of calamity, often good things are yielded or come. We learn more about our world, about ourselves, and about our faith. What we have learned from living through this period in the history of the world, in our nation, and in particularly this city, Auckland, I would like to spend a few moments just reflecting on. Well, they're personal reflections. I would love to have been able to open this up to a congregation and have a discussion about it. What are the things you've discovered about yourself, about our world, and about your own Christian faith and journey? So this second short homily today are my personal reflections, and I hope they might trigger a response in you as well, as you reflect on what your learnings might have been. The first is, and I've hinted at this on a couple of occasions, appreciate the small mercies. Appreciate the little things. Family. For those of you living with a family or a member of your family, and I'm aware that for some of you, of course, you're on your own, in your own little space. But for those of us who are sharing our space, yeah, there can be annoying moments and maybe even some mini flare-ups from time to time. We need our space, don't we? But don't we also start to recognize the great things about each other? it's not so bad after all, waking up to those people that we love in our own household and who are experiencing the common things that happen in our day-to-day living in a lockdown. And those of you who are on your own, probably you are appreciating the technology that allows you to FaceTime or email or even just phone your friends and your siblings and members, other members of your family, maybe grandkids or children. Appreciate the small mercies, shelter. Most of us have adequate shelter that we take for granted. And millions of people in our world don't have it. We have a chap across the road who spent the entire lockdown in a bus shelter, all covered up with his rugs and blankets. He's done the nearly 100 kilometre ultra marathon in a bus shelter, and I hope he's helped himself to our community garden, because there has been a mysterious person taking some of those plants, which is great, and that's what they're there for. Appreciate the small mercies. Food. In our household, one of our biggest problems is deciding what are we going to have for dinner tonight. And it's not because of lack of food. It's probably more that we have an abundance of food and we take it for granted instead of being grateful for it. The little things. Nature around us. We live in an amazing city. None of us are very far from a green park or maybe a coastline, salt water. And I've confessed to you that I was too head down and miserable in the early weeks of lockdown. And I had to learn to lift my head even when I was out running and see the beauty of creation. I happened to be able to run on the Auckland waterfront and look out and see the beauty of the islands, Rangitoto and Motutapu, and maybe Waiheke even way in the distance. Lift our heads and enjoy the wonder of God's creation. Appreciate the small mercies. Viktor Frankl, the great author and psychiatrist who was imprisoned by the Nazis in a concentration camp for being a Jew, one day he looked out through the slats that was meant to be a window, out beyond the barbed wire fence, and he saw a little yellow flower just breaking through the soil, and it was enough to lift his spirits incredibly and assisted him. Those little things assisted him, even in such squalid circumstances, to survive. If you haven't read his book, Man's Search for Meaning, then track it down. So let's be thankful for our small mercies, for the little things that we so often miss. Secondly, check your perspective. Jesus confronted the Pharisees with a loss of perspective. Their pettiness over minuscule rules and regulations meant that they failed to see the big picture and they missed out on what God was doing right in front of them. We read from Matthew's Gospel again, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former. You blind guides, you strain out the gnat, but swallow a camel." And I have to admit that I have grumbled and moaned a lot about many things during this time. But then I watch the news at night and I see those little kids abandoned in Afghanistan to starve to death. Their mothers have nothing to give them. Their fathers are long gone. And yet we still here have so much. An overabundance, as I've said, of food and medical care and protection. Check our perspective. You know, the world you will know, the world has had pandemics before, much worse, in fact, than the one that we've been experiencing. And they had no real medical defense. The bubonic plague at times in history has been just devastating. The Black Death in England in the 14th century saw 20% of England die from the plague from 1361 to 1362 in just 1 year. 20% of the population died. Even in this country, the Spanish flu last century, between October and December, just 3 months in 1918, just after the First World War, killed about 9,000 people in just 3 months. No other event has claimed so many New Zealand lives in such a short time. Perspective, perspective. Thirdly, I have learnt that life is fragile. I guess I've known that, but some of us have experienced that in this lockdown period. The deaths of two precious folk known to us here at St Andrew's Community, Kim and Fermier. Their deaths this year have shaken many of us. And that they should decline so rapidly and be gone, relatively young and strong, leaving grieving family and close friends. Life is fragile. We never know when it's going to be taken from us. The world is in turmoil. Floods, volcanoes, wars, and famine. And yet a microscopic virus has had the superpowers on their knees. Indeed, we live in a fallen world, however you interpret that phrase. A discussion perhaps worth having later on. Adam and Eve get the blame for an awful lot, don't they? But I'm not sure that that's the whole deal. We are reminded again in our reading from Romans, which we have just had, that in all things, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, and nothing ever will. Even beyond our life on this planet, in this great universe, even beyond that, God is there for us. And that brings me to my last learning. I guess there's been other peripheral ones, but God is in the midst of our human turmoil. One of the most enduring images for the Christian is the cross of Christ with all the broken souls there at Golgotha and the depravity of the Roman oppression all around them. And a religion, the Jewish religion at that time, becoming distorted. And into the world comes God, emptying himself in Christ, who dies to win our salvation and that of the world. God in the midst of human turmoil. And at the worst of times, God will be there for us. That is the center of our faith, Christ on a cross. And when the time comes, he will be there to transport us to our eternal dwelling, where there are no more tears or anguish or pain or sickness, united together with our loved ones, enjoying his eternal home for us for eternity. And that's the best perspective to have. In the meantime, Isaiah 40 and Hebrews 12, let's lift our drooping limbs and run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, who has been there before us and runs beside us. Amen. May it be so for you and for me and for us all. Amen. Let's close our service now by praying together and then we'll sing the closing hymn. Let us pray. Dear God, we do pray that we will learn and grow from the experience of these last 3 or so months. And we continue to uplift those who've really done it tough. We have had families who have had to deal with the COVID virus. And as we've mentioned, we've had families who have been broken in their hearts because of the loss of loved ones. And again, we think of them and pray for them. But we thank you for this journey. We thank you that you have been faithful to us. And we look forward to rounding the corner now and moving into the end of this year when we can focus our attention on the reason for our existence and the way in which you came to our world and to reveal yourself to us, but also to save us and secure our future. And so we thank you for our time together now, and we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And so we close today with a song that kind of summarizes it all, really. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Be my focus. Be my greatest priority. Let's sing this together.
And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who lived to death pursued? Amazing love, how can it be that
now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. That's all, folks. We'll see you in a little while. Have a great Christmas. Bye.